Buenas tardes a todos. Vamos a empezar con el profesor George Maeda. ¿Cómo viene del Instituto Kyushu de tecnología en Japón? Es el líder de un proyecto de nanosatélites que se llama BIRDS. Y tanto el profesor Maeda como el profesor Shibata están aquí para invitarnos a dos diferentes programas de posgrados que ellos tienen. En particular, el profesor Maeda va a hablarnos en una primera plática acerca del proyecto BIRDS que ellos tienen.
So, first, I want to thank Carlos and AEM for inviting me.
Lo primero que quiero hacer es agradecer a Carlos y a la Agencia Espacial Mexicana por invitarme.
I first met Carlos in the fall of 2015.
La primera vez que conoció a Carlos fue en el otoño de 2015.
And during that visit, we talked about organizing a Mexican-Japan education.
Durante esa visita, ellos hablaron de generar un programa México-Japón de educación.
And then we actually did that education forum last year in Guadalajara.
De hecho ya lo hicieron el año pasado en Guadalajara de manera paralela al IEC.
IEC.
En Guadalajara. Fue alrededor de 2 horas.
And it proved to be very effective because Carlos brought from Mexican side many universities, including
La reunión fue muy fructífera dado que, por ejemplo, Carlos trajo del lado mexicano a varias universidades, incluido el Tecnológico Nacional de México y CONACYT.
And from the Japan side, I brought Professor Cho, Japan Embassy, and Jackson.
Y del lado japonés, el profesor Maeda trajo al profesor Cho, a la embajada japonesa, a JAXA.
So the Japanese side made several presentations and the Mexican side made several presentations. So,
de ambos lados se hicieron varias presentaciones.
And because of that, many good things have happened.
Y a partir de eso, varias cosas muy buenas han ocurrido.
This is what I'm going to talk about. Tell you briefly about QTech and the BIRDS project.
En esta plática va a hablar brevemente acerca de QTech y del proyecto BIRDS.
So my name is G. Maeda. My boss is Mengu Cho. He's the director of this laboratory. You don't have to translate. They can read it. This is my laboratory, and this is my university. Kyushu Institute of Technology, which is long, so the abbreviation is QTech. This is the logo for QTech. This is the logo for my laboratory. And this is the logo for briefly talk about Q10. Next, please. So that's my university, and that's the city where we're located. Next, please. So we're west of Tokyo by about 1,000 kilometers. So that's about an hour and a half by airplane. We're on the southern island of Kyushu. And Akita means north, so we're in the north part of Kyushu Island. My university has three different campuses. I'm at Tobata campus. And after I talk, Professor Shibata will talk. He's at Wakamatsu campus. And we have a third campus at Iizuka. So we're a little bit spread apart. Next, please. Yes?
Your campus on life science, what is it?
That's a good question. You should ask Professor Shibata.
Okay.
When he speaks.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
So she's asking, what is life science? So we are over 100 years old. These are the two guys who started our university. Then and now. Next, please. We have about 6,000 students.
Tenemos alrededor de 6,000 estudiantes.
And about 300 students from overseas, from 38 countries.
Son alrededor de 300 estudiantes extranjeros de 38 países diferentes.
360 faculty members.
360 profesores.
This is the front gate of my campus.
Esa es la puerta frontal del campus.
And that's an example of a CubeSat.
Y ese es un ejemplo de los CubeSat.
Next, please. So the outline of my talk. I guess there's no need to translate this. I'm going to go all the way through here. So I just covered Q-Tech. Motivation means motivation about the BIRDS project. Next, please.
So why don't you continue talking? Because there's a technical problem with the computer.
Oh, it froze?
Yes.
Yeah.
So somewhere. That happens. Okay. Next,
please. Motivation. We want a project which in the span of 2 years, the students can do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6.
So, ellos tienen un proyecto en el cual durante dos años, que dura dos años, y durante esos dos años realizan estas seis actividades. Perdón.
And 2 years is unusual because in the commercial world it takes at least 5 years.
Dos años es inusual, dado que en la parte comercial toma alrededor de 5 años.
Do it in 2 years because the length of the master's degrees is 2 years.
Pero lo hacen ellos en dos años porque el periodo que dura la maestría es de dos años.
So the students begin by designing the satellite themselves.
Así que los estudiantes empiezan diseñando el satélite por ellos mismos.
We sign a contract with JAXA to do this launch.
Ellos han firmado ya un contrato con JAXA para el lanzamiento del nanosatélite.
And the 2 years includes at least 3 months in orbit.
Y los 2 años de la maestría y del programa incluyen al menos 3 meses del satélite en órbita.
How did you launch the
satellite? Via the International Space Station.
Use
a Japanese, Russian, or American. We're not able to choose. We signed a contract with JAXA. The contract says CubeSats will go from the ground to the ISS.
La pregunta es cómo hacen para lanzar los nanosatélites. Ellos firman un contrato con JAXA y lo lanzan a través de Japón, Rusia y Estados Unidos. Cualquiera de esas 3 opciones, el nanosatélite va a la Estación Espacial Internacional y de ahí es lanzado.
Right. Whatever, available launcher.
El lanzador que esté en ese momento disponible.
But once we sign the contract, we don't have to wait because you signed the contract.
Sí, una vez que se ha firmado el contrato, no se tiene que esperar porque ya está firmado el contrato.
And so to answer this motivation question is this. Therefore knows the whole process from start to end.
La motivación es que se tiene todo el proceso y se sabe todo el proceso desde el inicio hasta el final. Los estudiantes están presentes en todo el proceso.
Next week. So learning the whole process is important. Design, red door, engineering model, flight model, deployment in space. There's also environmental testing. This thing operates in a very harsh environment, so at every stage you have to do environmental testing. So the students do all of that themselves.
Los estudiantes hacen todo el proceso, desde el diseño, la construcción, bueno, el diseño, el modelado, la construcción y por supuesto, después el ponerlo en el espacio. Y durante todo este proceso se requieren muchos exámenes o pruebas a los diferentes componentes, dado que va a estar funcionando en el espacio.
Next please. So, if you can create such an engineer, he or she is very useful, one of these 2-3. Now, a lot of our partners have no space agency at all, so this is a possibility, but of course Mexico, you have one already. The other thing they can do is return to the university and start an academic space program in their university, something new for their university, or they can start a space engineering company. So we expect each graduate to do 1, 2, or 3.
So es muy importante entrenar a estudiantes en ingeniería espacial y se espera que hagan o se incorporen a una de estas 3 acciones. Primero es que algunos de los socios de QTEC no tienen sus propias agencias espaciales, entonces podrían regresar a sus países para desarrollar su propia agencia espacial, o bien regresar a sus universidades e iniciar programas académicos en, de ingeniería del espacio, o bien crear su propia compañía de ingeniería del espacio.
Next please. So, traditional approach is no good. This is the traditional approach. Homework, lectures, exam hell, living in the library. This is traditional university. And for what we want to do, it's no good. This is what we do. All of it's hands-on.
Lo que nos dice es que como lo hemos venido haciendo, la educación como la hemos venido haciendo, no es la más correcta. Con muchas tareas, muchas clases, vivir en la biblioteca y exámenes de pesadilla no son precisamente la mejor manera para aproximarnos a esta parte. Entonces, lo que ellos proponen y lo que ellos están haciendo es simplemente que los estudiantes vayan y metan las manos y hagan todo ahí.
So, this is different from this, okay? It's different. I did not say it's easy.
Que lo único que he dicho es que es diferente. No dijo que era sencillo.
It's a lot of work.
Requiere muchísimo trabajo.
So our project is this, the world's first constellation of multinational CubeSats. These are the participating nations. I'll continue. Next slide.
Problems again.
It's stuck again.
Yes.
It's stuck again.
So if you start your practice lessons from the start, how do you apply the theory to the students? How do you think theory needed?
Well, they do this on the sideline because they have to enroll in regular courses as well. So they get the theory.
So they do have like the traditional teaching background.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
They have to do a lot of coursework.
But for
the project itself, though,
it's
all laboratory.
La pregunta es, bueno, ¿cómo enseña la parte teórica a sus estudiantes? La respuesta es, de todas maneras hay que pasar por la parte tradicional, aprender la parte teórica, y el proyecto aparte es de ir ya a meter las manos, es decir, no se libran.
So this is our team back in November 2015. These are the countries and these are the members. Next, please. I'll go through this quickly since you won't know any of these people. Next, please. Japanese team. Next, please. The Ghana team. Next, please. Mongolian team. Next, please. The Bangladesh team. Next, please. They don't have a satellite, but they operate the ground stations.
Ellos no tienen satélite, pero ellos operan la parte terrena, la estación terrena.
And this is what they're doing all the time. Weekly meetings and brainstorming sessions.
Es lo que hacen todas las semanas, con reuniones cada semana, sesiones de ideas. Lluvia de ideas.
Vacuum, thermal vacuum testing.
Es la cámara de termo vacío.
It simulates the space environment.
Es para simular el ambiente del espacio.
So the name comes from this Joint Global Multinational Birds Project, or JGMNB. But even this is hard to pronounce, so we just took B, Birds Project. Next, please. The heat traits. Kick off to on-orbit operation under 2 years. Low-cost launch because we use a space station. The students have come up with a common design, just confirmed at CDR. With a common design, each national team builds their own CubeSat. So all of the CubeSats are exactly the same.
So las cosas importantes a tomar en cuenta de este proyecto es que se construye el CubeSat durante 2 años en todo su proceso hasta ponerlo en órbita. El lanzamiento es de muy bajo costo. Los estudiantes parten de un diseño en común que se confirma con la etapa del CDR, y una vez que tienen sus diseños, construye cada nación, los estudiantes de cada nación construyen sus propios nanosatélites, sus CubeSat, para ponerlos en órbita.
And each respective team has their respective university install operated ground station.
So, las universidades de sus países tienen que construir sus propias estaciones terrenas para operar su nanosatélite.
So, grand total of 7 ground stations.
En total tienen 7 estaciones terrenas.
Next, please. So, the 5 go up in the same rocket. It docks with the ISS. They're transferred to the ISS. And then the astronauts inside here will open a window and throw out each one, one by one. And this is LEO, low Earth orbit, about 400 kilometers above Earth.
En la primera etapa del proyecto BERT, ellos construyeron 5 CubeSats. Los 5 CubeSats se fueron en la misma nave hacia la Estación Espacial Internacional. No, todavía no se van. Están todavía en tierra. Van a la Estación Espacial Internacional en la misma nave. Ahí van a ser transferidos a la Estación Espacial Internacional y de ahí, pues literal, van a abrir la ventana y los van a lanzar uno por uno. La Estación Espacial Internacional está en una órbita baja que está a 400 kilómetros sobre la Tierra.
But actually, they're already delivered to JAXA.
Okay, so they're already in space.
No,
they're with JAXA.
Okay,
with JAXA. They're waiting for launch.
Okay.
La primera generación de los nanosatélites CubeSat están ya completamente construidos y están ya empacados en JAXA. En mayo van a tomarse una visita para irse a la estación espacial.
Now, this altitude, 400 kilometers, there's still quite a bit of air. Atmosphere. Okay, so even the ISS, once a month, they have to boost it up quite a bit. Otherwise, it will come down. So this satellite too will be in orbit below here. Okay, so maybe 390. So it's hitting a lot of air drag. So it can only stay up there for about 6 months. By drag, it'll come down.
Aun cuando la Estación Espacial Internacional está en el espacio, la órbita en la que está todavía tiene atmósfera y la Estación Espacial Internacional cada cierto tiempo tiene que recibir un pequeño empujón porque si no se caería a la Tierra, y lo que va a ocurrir con los satélites es que van a ir perdiendo energía al moverse a través de la atmósfera y solamente pueden mantenerse en el espacio alrededor de 6 meses.
Next, these are the missions of this particular satellite. One is to take photographs of their homeland. It has no GPS, but we have another way to figure out the location, and based on that, we will calculate atmosphere density. Anyway, these missions were determined by the students themselves. They selected these missions.
So, estas son las 6 misiones que tiene ahorita el proyecto BERT y fueron diseñadas por los estudiantes. Ellos no les dijeron cuáles eran las misiones, sino los estudiantes decidieron cuáles eran. Una de ellas es tomar fotografías de su propio país. Los nanosatélites no llevan GPS, pero hay otras formas de determinar su posición de manera muy precisa, y eso lo combinan con calcular y medir la densidad atmosférica conforme el nanosatélite se va moviendo y va cayendo hacia la Tierra.
So, there's no room for GPS on this satellite. So, next slide.
No hay espacio para un GPS en el satélite.
But we have a lot of ground stations, 7. So through triangulation, we can figure out precisely the location.
So usando las 7 estaciones terrenas, ellos pueden observar al CubeSat y utilizando triangulación pueden determinar cuál es la posición del satélite.
Next, please. So our stations are in Ghana, Nigeria, Thailand, Bangladesh, Taiwan, QTech, and Mongolia. So this is the ground network for BERT 1. Okay? Now, we have BERT 2, which is also now up and running. Malaysia, Philippines, Bhutan. So that will bring in 3 more stations. And and we'll have Earth 3 running. So our network will become bigger and bigger.
Estas son las 7 estaciones terrenas que tienen a partir de la primera generación de BERTs. El segundo programa ya está en proceso y a partir de ello tendrán 3 estaciones terrenas más. Y en octubre de este año empieza el programa 3. Entonces se van a ir añadiendo cada vez más estaciones terrenas.
So the problem with our satellite is bandwidth is small. Does not have a big antenna, right? So it's like 1,000 BPS or 9,000 BPS. However, you can compensate that if you have a lot of the ground stations. So that's a bonus of the ground station.
La transmisión de los nanosatélites es bastante débil, pero se compensa teniendo varias estaciones en tierra.
Next, please. So I show you one example of a ground station. This is one in Ghana, SPs. So they do all the work, and it's excellent training for their undergraduate students and their staff and other people. They have to solve all the problems on their own.
Este es el ejemplo de una de las estaciones terrenas en Ghana. Ellos tienen que construir toda la estación terrena, por lo tanto, esto representa un gran entrenamiento para los chicos de licenciatura y también para los profesores, dado que ellos tienen que solucionar todos los problemas que se presenten. Especialmente a ingenieros mecánicos y eléctricos.
Next, this is the receiving equipment, mostly. So this is electrical engineering, but then again, you have hardware and software. So it's plenty of work for lots of undergraduates.
Este es el equipo que recibe la señal y son equipos de radio. Es cosa eléctrica, pero requiere tanto hardware como software. Entonces es mucho trabajo para los estudiantes de licenciatura.
Next, please. So last year we had a workshop so that we could invite all the participating nations. Next, please. So we had an official program, 3 days, next, please. And president of University of Mongolia, Ghana, professor in Taiwan, so all these people came together for, actually, the purpose was the CDR, the critical design review. But anyway, next, please. Lots of this was done. This is very, very productive. Can you mention that?
Perdón. La reunión fue muy importante, organizaron una reunión hace un año que todo tenía que ver con la revisión del diseño de los nanosatélites y se reunió gente de varias partes del mundo y fue muy importante porque pudieron estar frente a frente trabajando en el diseño de los nanosatélites.
The students were building satellites, but QTech is building a human.
Los estudiantes están construyendo satélites, pero QTech está construyendo la red humana.
Next, please. So we also had a big press conference, invited the local news media. He's the president of QTech. That's my boss, Professor Cho. That's project manager, Tylo. News media asked a lot of questions, and of course, in the evening we were shown on television news.
Hicieron una conferencia de prensa, hubieron muchas preguntas de parte de la prensa y en la noche salieron en las noticias locales.
Next, please. So this is the most important item for this workshop, the letter of intent. We all signed an agreement, and the agreement is that we work together long term, 10, 15, 20 years as a group.
Una de las cosas más importantes de esta reunión es que firmaron una carta de intención Y esta carta de intención es muy importante porque lo que acordaron fue trabajar juntos como una como un gran grupo durante los siguientes 15 o 20 años.
So this was the first birds workshop. We plan to have one every year now. The second one will take place in Ghana this year in November. Next one will be in Mongolia next year. And after that will be in Bangladesh. So they're already planned.
Este fue el primer taller, primer workshop del proyecto BIRDS. El siguiente es en Ghana. Se planea que sea cada año, entonces este año es en Ghana, el siguiente en Mongolia y el siguiente en Bangladesh.
Because if you make these satellites, they go up and they come down and then you say that's the end of the project, it's worthless. It's worthless. Unless you can sustain some sort of grouping, it's just not worthwhile to do all this work. So the satellites are just a vehicle to create this human network, whereby we can have the workshops once a year, talk about collaboration. Also, at each workshop, we announce results. People present their findings. We can invite a lot of students. The students will understand the academic process. So this is the real core of the project, this activity. The students think the heart of the project is putting their gadgets together, but that's just a small portion of the entire agenda. Next, please. So BIRDS 1 will be deployed in May, very soon. BIRDS 2 will be deployed 1 year after that. BIRDS 3 will be deployed 1 year after that. And my boss says he wants to keep going. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
En la fecha de lanzamiento de los tres primeros proyectos, BIRDS, mayo de este año, el siguiente mayo y mayo del 2019. Y su jefe está seguro que esto va a continuar en BIRDS 4, 5, 6, 7.
No, that's a good question. The objective is always the same. It's to train students so that they can completely do a project from A to Z. That's the main thing, train students, okay? The satellite itself is secondary. That's what it does, it's not that important. Because with a small 1U, there's not much you can do anyway.
Yes, exactly.
So if you can train 2 or 3 students to run the whole process, we hope they go back to their own countries and then repeat that process so that they can teach their own people in their own country.
La pregunta es si el objetivo del proyecto cambia cada vez. Y la respuesta es que no, que el objetivo del proyecto es siempre el mismo. Y ese es entrenar a los estudiantes. La misión de cada uno de los CubeSats es diferente y eso es secundario. Pero el objetivo principal es entrenar a los estudiantes para que ellos, una vez que regresen a sus países, puedan esparcir ese conocimiento y construir más CubeSats.
Next, please. So, any questions?
No questions. Thank you, Mr. Meta, for coming here this afternoon. I have a couple of questions. The first of at least these four is, who is the owner of the satellites in this case?
La primera pregunta es, ¿quién es el dueño del CubeSat construido?
Each one has to be registered with the United Nations. Okay? So it's registered with that country. So the countries will register. But the owner is probably the institution that paid for the satellite.
No tiene dueño. Se registra como...
Se registra en Naciones Unidas.
Es de Naciones Unidas. Y el honor, digámoslo así, de haber lanzado el satélite pertenece a la universidad que pagó el costo.
Sí, pero yo estoy cuestionando. Yeah, there's an owner, and that's the institution that paid for the satellite, because there's responsibilities. You know, let's say that the CubeSat hits another satellite or a cow. Okay, so that's a very interesting question, because there is an owner, and the owner, el dueño, is the institution that paid for the satellite.
El comentario es que en realidad sí tiene un dueño, porque hay alguien que es responsable de ese satélite y la responsabilidad la adquiere la institución que paga ese nanosatélite por si golpea a otro satélite o a una vaca o a lo que sea.
The second question is, it's very related to the previous question, it's how do you coordinate the frequency of those CubeSats? You previously mentioned that you have to make the register of the object.
Okay. For these types of satellites,
yes.
Everybody all over the world is currently using amateur radio frequencies. So that's coordinated through the existing amateur radio organizations.
Of each country, of each university, who has to do
well,
that?
Okay, you have one in each country, but there's also a superstructure called the International Amateur Radio Union.
Mm-hmm.
So they are doing the coordination. So to answer your question, it's pretty much a established procedure.
Do you perform that procedure?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So you do the paperwork?
Yes.
Kyushu Institute of Technology does the paperwork?
A portion of it. But then the ground stations have to be done by each country.
No, definitely.
The third question actually goes through the ground station. Is how do you share the information for the orbit determination? I mean, I guess that you're using different ground stations for that orbit determination. Because all these birds that are involved in this project, how is that they share one to each other of this information?
It's fully shared.
Fully shared.
Probably using some internet scheme, mm-hmm. But that information is fully shared internally.
And the third, yeah, it's already class announcer, it's who pay for ground stations.
Oh, we expect the partners to solve that problem. But it uses amateur radio equipment, so it's not that expensive.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of these stations, individuals build in their backyard, so it's the same thing. So it's between $5,000 and $20,000 US. But you need an antenna that tracks.
Okay.
It is possible to participate with instruments inside the program. For example, I work in a university and I want to build a board station, a ground station. It is possible to participate in the program without students. You can contribute a ground station.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. That's all.
Okay.
If no more, then I'd like to give the floor to my colleague.
Si no hay más comentarios, preguntas, le cedo la palabra a su colega, el profesor Shibata. ¿No? ahora estas cosas tienen que ser accesibles para todo el mundo, entonces mantenemos mi producción.
It's not working.
No.
Okay.
Necesitamos algunas cosas técnicas. Esperen un momento.
Yeah, with the codec of with VLC, maybe the PowerPoint is going to.
From the others, and the PowerPoint file must have.
Did you make introduction already?
Yeah. No. Bueno, ahora les presento al profesor Tom Shibata de la misma universidad, y él nos va a presentar lo que hacen el programa de robótica, lo que hacen en esta área. Please, profesor Shibata.
Well, thank you very much for giving me a very precious opportunity. And I came here to advertise our global robotics course. And currently, so I already there are many foreign students there, and I myself have more than around eight English students and also one European student, so to my knowledge. And unfortunately, we don't have much membership. Maybe two or three in other campus, so that's fine. But we are hoping to get some new. In particular, PhD students to our global course. That's all. That's my aim. So my background is robotics and computational neuroscience, and also I frequently use machine learning application. I frequently apply machine learning technology to robotics, in particular from intelligent robotics point of view. That's my brief introduction. Now I'm an executive board member of the Robotics Society in Japan and also Japanese Neural Network Society. So anyway, so here are outline, but so because of time limitation, just keep as much as possible. So first of all, Wakamatsu campus, please. I'd like to introduce Wakamatsu campus briefly. famous industrial robots company. Its main land is in Kyushu. Main company is an existing Ikita Kyushu, actually. So we are so close. Q-Tech is so close. And the founder of Yasutawa Electronics and the founder of Q-Tech was the same.
Okay.
Yeah. So we are brothers. So that's why. So that's one of the very important reason why we are working in robotics in Ikita Kyushu. That's why. So actually, we are our campus, Wakamatsu campus, is inside Ikita Kyushu Science and Research Park. So this is the central research area, and who is always cooperating with Ikita Kyushu City. And this is, shows Ikita Kyushu Science and Research Park, and this is our campus. And except our campus, besides our campus, there is Ikita Kyushu City University and Waseda University. A graduate school of Masters University. So and we are collaborating from educational point of view and also sometimes research point of view. So this is a very unique area in Japan. So where we are national and city and private universities are collaborating. This is very unique. Okay, so just watch this. Next, please. Sorry. Went back. Okay. Oops. This is the end. Okay. So, so this slide shows a global AAR course. Actually, AAR is the abbreviation of Advanced Assistive Robotics. It's too advanced. So just for students, please think this is just a global robotics course. Because robotics is a multidisciplinary area. So that should integrate many different principles, such as integrated circuits, control sensing, and systems, computer systems. And also machine learning, cognitive behavioral science, neuroscience, blah, blah, blah. So, actually, in our campus, we have many different types of faculty members, and we can cover these different areas for research robotics. That's a very good nature of our campus. So this shows, they are all Asians, so they are working together in some practical, some on-the-job training course for intelligent robotics. And this picture shows our journal club. All of them are so Japanese students and also foreign students are together studying the recent journals together. And the official language is, of course, in English. Okay. And yeah, the point is, no Japanese is required actually to get a degree because our distributed materials are prepared in English, so no problem. But learning Japanese and Japanese cultures are strongly encouraged. So if you want to get some job in Japan, sometimes you need actually high-level Japanese. But now, some of you know, we have different types of characters. And the most difficult one for you is kanji characters, like Chinese. Very difficult. But now we are, our society is relaxing that constraint. So try not to use kanji characters as much as possible. This is a representative classes. These are representative of classes of the global protocols. So, for example, this is practicum that I showed you in the last slide, journal club, and of course, some basics in robotics, robot kinematics, and also what dynamics is. And other classes for many different types of disciplines. I'm going to introduce representative faculty members and their research. So then you can clearly understand what we are doing. Hopefully. Yes. today I'm going to show you their videos and also some slides. Not everything, it's too long.
Society, there are growing expectations for autonomous robots and cars that operate more smartly, cleverly, and intelligently, as well as for medical and welfare support. To people. Meanwhile, we are facing grave environmental and energy issues on a global scale. It is becoming increasingly important to develop new technologies that are harmonious and friendly to the environment and its inhabitants, and help conserve energy and natural resources. At the Graduate School of Life Science and Systems Engineering, we strive to comprehend.
Shape memory alloys that can memorize the original shape in the form of a metal. But because of the safety and also lightweight, he's been working with shape memory polymers, having comparable features to this in conventional shape memory alloys. So can you, I don't think this works. And by using the new such shape memory polymers, this kind of rail robot can be built. Okay? And so can you move this? It doesn't work. Okay, so please just imagine if you have such a device that actually activates like muscles.
This is like an exoskeleton, right?
Right.
This is okay.
So this is a typical use for assistive device, assistive technologies. But you can use it also if you want to use such a device in a certain amount of time. Okay. So what's the next? Yes. And so I'd like to briefly introduce Professor Associate Professor Hamid Bosin. So he's interested in brain-like computer. Okay, so computer system. Next, please. Yes. So the idea and approach, this approach is to integrate so hardware-oriented computing and also soft computing. And also he's working for applications, lots of applications. For example, for automatic driving and also for service robots. Okay, let's go to the next. continuous loops. Yeah. So this slide shows typical using very interesting applications. So he is integrating, he's been integrating hardware oriented deep neural networks. Some of you might know deep neural networks. Recently, so business people are really focusing on using deep neural networks for their business because of its quite high performance on pattern recognition. It outperforms conventional machine learning or state-of-the-art machine learning technologies for pattern recognition. Have you ever heard deep learning? Deep neural networks? Okay, no, so very different. Yeah. Have you ever heard of machine learning? Machine learning. I have studied both. I studied from neural network, and after that, I studied a lot of machine learning and applied it a lot to my robotics research. And now, deep neural network comes, so we can avoid we actually need to know how to utilize this deep neural network. But unfortunately, usually it requires a very high performance computer. So it's not useful. So we cannot do embedded into this kind of vehicle. It's not possible. So we need to have some hardware oriented deep neural networks. In his case, he is an expert on FPGA design. So he's trying to implement deep neural network module into a FPGA network. Okay? And his applications. So later on, I'm going to show you.
What's the minimum capacity of computer needed to use
computers? Minimum capacity. For example, to learn, you need so many pieces of classification and have with GPUs. And nowadays, sometimes some workstation, very expensive workstation with multiple GPUs are available for you. And, still, it's too expensive to having very high capacity. So impossible. If you know car production people, they don't allow us to allow high performance computers. They want to make it cheaper and cheaper and cheaper and safer and safer. So the stress is really high. So these pictures show his applications, and the next place I'm going to show you some applications. So actually, from educational point of view, so Associate Professor Tom Cole is leading a robot called Sarko, and who's been developing this robot for many years, and has attended RoboCup home lead. There is a robot. So RoboCup has different types of categories. So one most popular one is support, SAPA. Okay. But now the categories are being added and home. So he's working on this kind of home. RoboCup at home category. So unfortunately, so we need to accelerate. So this is a big problem. For social implementation, for example, for care houses, they always complain it's slow. We can do it much faster. So that's a big problem. So anyway, so it has all many recognition and so actuation capabilities like this. Yeah, but I think this. So it has an alarm, and it's watching, and it recognizes these bubbles automatically and pick it up. And of course, it has an automatic navigation function too. Yeah, and this is trying to carry to this bubble. Okay, so I think this movie takes time, just sequence.
So I have a question there. So you have where you're trying to emulate the brain performance. are new functions.
No.
Various functions to add more functions.
Right. So it's in our, so his and some of our Hapatimic words, ultimate form. So ultimate input.
Is that
right?
Dynamic.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Yes. So that's one of the reasons why he is interested in using that PCA. PCA is programmable. So we can change the module, so learning module or some brain functions. So we can replace it so in the dynamic
module.
It is connected to the internet, and there are some learning modules, and we can change it.
The size of the hardware is computers. Well, you can.
Yes.
I was thinking this is one of the applications for UAVs.
Oh, okay. That's
why we are very concerned about weight.
Yes. So it's a very good point. He's an expert in that area.
Okay.
So I skipped one slide where showed this is a very interesting approach. It's a cloud-based brain-like computer, portable brain-like computer. So he is Professor Shi, and he is really an expert in robocar operation and also in deep ocean sea exploration with his AUVs. Okay, so next please. So this is his robot. He also forms a team in robot cycle, and he's been working with this robot. He's always developing and improving this robot. And these are results. What is the result? Actually, he hasn't won a robot sector for many years, for more than 8 years or 9 years. Yes. So now he doesn't have a competitor in Japan, inside Japan, but in, as he's shown, difficult to win the war. So still we need to work together. So actually I'm very much an advocate. So go to the next slide, please. The RoboCup also, of course, requires very nice computer vision. So this robot has this omnidirectional mirror, which can view the robot. So the surrounding environment. Okay, and by using this camera, so now it tries to locate itself in the circle field. So in this way, RoboCup is a platform, good platform, and giving us many challenges. So we need to think about functions. Okay. So we can skip this. And this is the one that I can show you. And he's an expert of AUVs for deep oceans. And because we are surrounded by the sea, Japan is surrounded by the sea, and there are many resources in the sea. So we need to develop such AUVs. Okay, and again, go to the next slide. Okay. So sorry for that. And the new issue, new challenge, is to sample some marine life by this robot. Yeah, next please. Yes, so it requires automatic navigation function and also automatic pattern recognition function and automatic sampling function. Of course, sometimes we can, a human operator can help, can assist it, but the whole thing we are trying to, so he is really trying to implement all, make it all automatic. So he's, of course, with this kind of development, he's been working in real-world evaluations, not only in Japan Sea, but also in the other sea. Okay. And what's the next please? So this is, maybe one more. Yes. So this video shows a collaborating work with Professor Associate Professor Lawrence Ma and Associate Professor Tamko. And in Kitakyushu, we are also working in this research direction and also real-world evaluation. So they are combining theoretical based, theory based AI and data driven AI to develop an automatic driving car. So unfortunately, so we can in reality we can listen to other fun voices from the world, but unfortunately it's not possible. So just let's see a little bit more. Yeah, so actually this is our campus, part of our campus. We automatically recognize the intersection and the signal and an info that happens here. And start. So make its own decision like this. Yes. So if your students come to our campus, so you can be involved in this kind of real world evaluation too. Okay, go to the next place. Again, this is a very long conversation. Yeah. And we are also, so I'm also a computational neuroscientist, so I do that in direction. So in such a way, we have some scientists, so neuroscientists. So by collaborating with them, so our associate professor Balasuma is developing some brain machine interface system for disabled people. Again, this is the interaction of assistive technology. To the next piece. Okay, now this is the final professor before that accepted me. And this is Professor Wada, and he's interested in human function developing human function substitution system. So, what's that? So, the next slide simplifies his process. Yeah. So, he's doing a lot of things in that direction, but this is one quite representative of his work. So he has developed these shoes having lots of different types of sensors to measure, quantitatively measure the walking pattern, walking activity of patients. So imagine if you can have this, what can you do if you have this kind of device? So it's yeah. So actually, he's been collaborating with many other hospitals and trying to apply this device for. In-home rehabilitation and also in hospital and rehabilitation. So medical doctors and also therapists can understand what happens during their rehabilitation very with a quantitative information. But this is quite informative. So this assists a lot for their rehabilitation. This could accelerate their rehabilitation. Can this do? Okay, finally, thank you very much for listening to this really a long talk, and we are coming to the ending part. So this slide shows my approach. Actually, so my background is robotics and kind of brain science, computational neuroscience, and also our laboratory is good at using machine learning technology and biomedical engineering. So there are many applications, and also I like collaborations with together. Other academic institutes and also companies like this. And as I told you, I have lots of students, and unfortunately, so far I am only faculty member of this laboratory. It's really tough. And most of the foreign students are from Indian Institute of Technology. And this year, some more foreign students will join my laboratory, and one is from Russia. Hopefully from this October or next year, I'd like to have mixed students in the next week. So, doesn't work. Okay, just keep it. Yeah. So, actually, if you watch my website, you see lots of publications, so journal publications, and in many different directions, not only for robotics, actually. They are, half of them are scientific papers and half of them are robotic papers. And today I just need to focus on my assistive robotics field. Okay? So there are some categories, and please go to next slide. Yes. Today I'm going to show you some two or three movements. So according to my research on rehabilitation, for rehabilitation, daily care, and prosthesis. Yeah. foster health education using the robot, dual arm robot, and also different types of sensors. So we are developing a system, new system, having new actuators and new sensors. And the problem here is a postural deficit in Parkinson's disease people. Not only for Parkinson's people, but also many other people have a deficit in their postural control. And for rehabilitation is still quite good. Not quantity. So subject they are doing helping rehabilitation in quite a subjective matter. So we want to provide some objective technologies for their rehabilitation to assist their rehabilitation. So in this case, this robot is trying to correct her posture. So this is still very, very preliminary step. And simultaneously, we are watching. Observing what happens to her posture and also what happens to her center of pressure of the throat to see her balance. Okay, so go to the next please. Yes, this is my typical example for daily care assistance. So actually, we innovated this task. So in the world, and now I have some computers. But it's good, we need to accelerate this research. So closing assistance is one of the most important daily functions and difficult action for robots because the shaft, close, is stretchable. So it has nonlinear dynamics. And also, we need to move it, the robot should move it. And close has a friction, something very difficult friction with human. And also, a human can also move during this task. It's a very difficult task. So that's why my approach is so everybody can agree. We can do it. Humans can do it. So why don't you teach how to do it to the robot?
Can the robot tie your shoes? Can the robot tie your shoes?
Tie shoes. There is not for direct issues, but there is such a that's all good point. Good research point. And there are some studies, not for shoes,
yeah.
just rope, for rope.
Yeah. Right.
Knots.
Right.
Making knots is already difficult. So I'm doing also real world evaluation. So this kind of challenging evaluation is really important. I thought before doing this real world evaluation, I thought maybe all the subjects felt really awful. So and sometimes some of them might run away from this. But actually, we were able to do it. So no problem. Okay, so what's the next piece? And the closing assistance consists of many different tasks. And in this case, this movie shows our developed pattern recognition function. It tries to detect the garment extremities and try to pick it up. And after that, give it to the subject, and the subject is trying to make a weird shot by itself. So in this case, I'm using a different type of robot. This is Toyota's robot. And so in cooperation with Toyota, so Toyota provides this human support robot to us. And now it finds some of the extremities, in this case I think color, and then try to pick it up. And this kind of function can be transferred to another robot, red robot, very easy, no problem. Okay, what's the next place? I think my final one. So, go to the next slide. Yes. Anyway, thank you very much for listening to my presentation. And this is my main message. Yes.
Bata.
So I wanted to get many questions. Thank you very much. I'm going to help you develop a new cooperation.
So you have also, you have both master's and PhD students?
Yes. So we are, so in our campus, we have only graduate students.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and there are master course and PhD course. But in particular, from this year, PhD course students are really welcome. Although, if there are some scholarship, we can accept master course.
¿Más preguntas?
¿Cómo se enrola uno en el curso de robótica global?
So how they can apply for the PhD or master's degree program in robotics?
In robotics.
Yes.
So our graduate school, so in general, our graduate school is totally open, so for foreign students, so in terms of admission.
El programa está abierto a cualquier estudiante extranjero.
In particular for Mexican students,
en particular para estudiantes mexicanos.
So TechNM will be making a call for application to pharmaceutical scholarship very soon.
El Tecnológico Nacional de México va a abrir una convocatoria en junto con CONACYT para entrar a este programa. Va a ser en los siguientes par de días, yo creo.
Hope we can get one or more students, PhD students, from this October.
Ellos esperan tener algunos estudiantes mexicanos para este octubre. Entonces, de hecho, el programa, la convocatoria es, básicamente está abierta, no es oficial todavía porque no se ha lanzado, pero el deadline para enviar los papeles es el 21 de marzo. Sobre eso se van a hacer 20, se van a seleccionar los 20 mejores estudiantes y sobre esos 20 mejores estudiantes el profesor Shibata va a entrevistar a los estudiantes y sobre ellos van a elegir a 8 y esos 8 serán aquellos que puedan preguntar por las becas en CONACYT.
And this course has its own website, so we will update that information very soon.
Este programa tiene su propio sitio web y ahí van a poner la información muy pronto. Bueno, nada más por si alguien más está interesado, el programa con ingeniería aeroespacial tiene también una convocatoria abierta que cierra el 21 de marzo para ir a hacer estudios de maestría o de doctorado con el profesor Maeda. Yes. Los invito a agradecer la presencia.
Muchas gracias a todos ustedes por su participación.